Macmillan Audio presents The Warrior Code, 11 Principles to Unleash the Badass Inside of You by T. Marie Hanible with Denene Millner. Read for you by T. Marie Hanible. Dear Mama, so many things I wish I could say. Conversations I wish we'd had. Moments I wish we could still share. Thank you for giving a lost little girl a place to call home. Introduction. No one is born a warrior. We don't come out of the womb with armor and weapons and the honor, courage, discipline, and strength to conquer life's toughest battles. To win the mightiest wars. That mettle, that ability to stare the enemy in the face, choose the right weapons, and fight with all one's might to survive, is learned and earned with time, with experience, with the knockdowns and wherewithal to get back up again, no matter what, every time, having learned a little bit more about what it takes to do so, no matter how strong or cunning the opposition. This is no easy task. The opponent is a sly one, for sure. Not even in most cases. A real person we can touch, see, or hit. Indeed, our biggest foe is not a person at all. It is instead all the things that hold us back from realizing our true strength and ability to win at life. Fear, laziness, anger, ego, stubbornness, and so much more. Each threatens our greatest desires, that new job, true love, better connections with family and friends, stronger, fitter bodies, higher education, respect, stability, and brings the fight right to our doorstep, directly to our hearts and minds. Neither knife nor gun nor fist is brandished. But this enemy can be every bit as lethal to us humans as an AK-47 with a full clip. Being a true warrior, then, is it so much about our ability to throw hands, or shoot with precision, or conquer adversaries we can actually see? It's about identifying our inner strength, tapping into the very core of our being to overcome the everyday obstacles that threaten to derail us at every turn. We all have the skill, knowledge, and muscle to get this done. To not only endure, but also to thrive, to be unbreakable. I know this to be true because my life was not set up for survival, at least not an easy one. Before I'd even turned a year old, my father was shot dead in the street. My two-year-old brother crumpled at his feet. Not much longer after that, social services removed us from my mother's arms and dropped my brother and me into the complex, soul-sapping foster care system, leading to the Chicago home of a strict but loving couple that raised us in the whirlwind of poverty, old-school discipline, and a rotating crew of almost 24 foster children in and out of their 3-bedroom apartment. By age 17, I'd been kicked out of school, shot, piled into the back of several cop cars, handcuffed in a police interrogation room, awakened in a hospital bed after a drug-induced fainting spell, pregnant and an active member of a dangerous gang. That I made it out of all of that is a miracle. The military saved my life. I survived the streets of Chicago, but becoming a Marine gave me my armor, made me a warrior. At every turn, I proved myself as a woman and a single mother in the military, destroying every physical, mental, and emotional barrier to take my rightful place as one of the first women to serve in a male-dominated combat mission during Operation Enduring Freedom, OEF, Operation Iraqi Freedom, OIF. So strong was my pull to defend my country. I deployed to Iraq, leaving behind my daughters, my family, my friends, and all I knew and loved to join my band of brothers on the ground. My work as a recruiter in the military, as well as one of the Marines hand-selected to assist the Marine Corps in its mission to open combat roles to women, paved the way for more strong women to join the military's elite. And after retiring from 2 decades of duty, I used my mix of tough love and Marine mettle to mentor everyday men and women on the hit Fox reality show American Grit. When I consider where I've been, and my journey to the right here and now, I know that every trial, every heartbreak, every decision, the good and the bad, every bullet made me the warrior I am today. Because I chose not to let the adversity I faced define or wreck me, I carried on. I'm nobody's hero. I'm a woman, a mother, a daughter, a philanthropist, a Marine, a badass, a survivor. And I have a little something to say about what it takes to be a warrior. Pro tip, it's a lot more than muscle. Follow my journey in the Warrior Code, and you just might see that you too have what it takes to win your own personal wars. Marine Gunnery Sergeant T. Hanible. 1. Improvise, adapt, and overcome. Get some grit. The Warrior Code, principle number 1. To be gritty is to keep putting one foot in front of the other. To be gritty is to hold fast to an interesting and purposeful goal. To be gritty is to invest day after week after year in challenging practice. To be gritty is to fall down 7 times and rise 8. Angela Lee Duckworth, academic author. Grit is perseverance, that passion we use to push through adversity, no matter the obstacles. That stick-to-itiveness, it comes wrapped in qualities like discipline, self-motivation, fearlessness, and a smidge of optimism. There's plenty of research that suggests that when it comes to achievement, having grit is as important, if not more, than intelligence or talent. Ask any new Marine, and they'll likely tell you the same. Yes, of course, you have to have brains and brawn to make it through the crucible. The final physical evaluation, the test whether recruits have the physical, mental, and moral fortitude to be a Marine. But it's that grit, that dogged determination in your heart, your sinew, in every fiber of your being, that gets you through 54 hours of food and sleep deprivation, and 48 miles of marching while carrying 45 pounds of gear as you work together to overcome obstacles, problem solve, and help your fellow recruits ace the combat assault courses, the team building and warrior stations, and the leadership reaction course. When your body is weak and your mind is tired and telling you, give up, you're not going to make it. It's that grit that kicks in and propels you forward and sees you through the end. I believe we all have a bit of grit in us. It can reveal itself naturally, like in my case, when I had to lean on it to push through my challenging childhood. Or it could be drawn out of us like a bucket of water from a well when everything else in our lives has gone dry and we need the fortitude, the strength, the coping skills to quench our thirst and just keep pushing. My grit was born, bred, and nurtured in the midst of childhood trauma. Before I took my first step, before I could even say my own name, the odds were against me. I was born in Chicago to a man and a woman whose troubles never gave them peace, that refused to give them rest. When I was just 10 months old, that trouble found my father on a quiet street on the South Side, where he was walking with my big brother, a chocolate dewdrop, still in diapers, tottering on a pavement alongside our dad. Quick as a flash, someone walked right up to the two of them, pulled out a gun, and shot my father dead. Just left his body crumpled, bloody, right there in the middle of the street, with my brother standing over him screaming. From what little information I've managed to gather over the years, my brother wasn't hurt, but beyond that, I have no idea if the person who killed my father was ever found, arrested, or punished. This was the beginning of the end of our family and a tragic start to my life. Not long after that, I'm told, child services showed up at my mother's door, packed up my brother and me, and piled us into the back of a car, drove us away from my mother, away from our home, away from the only family and life we'd ever known.
Promises were exchanged. If she got herself together, child services told my mother, she could get her babies back. The moment she got herself together, my mother told child services, she would get her babies back. Those were promises never kept.
Instead, my brother and I ended up in the care of Minnie and William Hudson, an older couple who made a tacit agreement to house, clothe, feed, and love on us, to do all the things our mother simply could not and would not do. They kept the home on the south side, not too far from where my brother and I had been living, a tiny, crammed, three-bedroom apartment that held court for a rotation of children, numbering anywhere from 2 to 20 at any given time, sleeping on the couch, the floor, sometimes 2 or 3 to a bed. The two of them were the only parents I'd ever known, and their ragtag collection of foster care children would become my de facto extended family, a group of children who did not carry the same blood as I, but who stood in as sisters and brothers and play cousins and even mothers when I needed that nurturing touch, the touch that I never again got from my birth mother, who, despite promising to visit my brother and me, never came to see us. There were many visits from social services caseworkers, checking up on our well-being and offering counseling, but never, ever did my birth mother darken the threshold of the Hudson's door, much less step back into her role as our caretaker, as the mother who gave birth to 2 children and dedicated herself to feeding us, clothing us, loving us, praying over us. The magnitude of this was devastating, as it would be, I imagine, for any child aching for her mother's kiss, her mother's touch. I was consumed with wondering where my mother was, what she was doing, why she didn't come for me, if she loved me. Minnie Hudson, then still my foster mother, never minced words when I asked the questions. From the moment I was able to understand the words coming out of her mouth, she told me all she knew about how we'd come to live with her. And when she got updates on my mother's whereabouts and living situation, she made a point of letting me know too. The more I was able to understand the gravity of my mother's actions, the more able I was to chart her absence. The larger the hole in my heart grew. The emptiness was compounded by the news that, at some point, she got pregnant again and had a baby girl, a child. I assumed she kept and cared for on her own. There I'd be cuddled up next to my brother in a tiny corner of our bed, staring at the ceiling, listening to the rhythm of his breath and wondering where this new little sister was. If she was cuddled up next to my mother at that very moment, what their room looked like, why my mother loved her enough to raise her, but not even check up on me. Eventually, my adopted mom would tell me that my little sister wasn't in my birth mother's care at all, that she gave up that baby too, and she was being raised by our grandparents. Knowing this tore me to pieces too. My grandparents loved my little sister enough to take her in, but not my brother and me. We were beasts of no nation. I was a motherless child. But Minnie Hudson was there for me. She stepped into that empty space. Mama was a grandmotherly type, the kind of no-nonsense woman who, typical of her generation, thought children should be seen and not heard. She and Dad were already well into their 60s when my brother and I arrived. And by the time I hit double digits, they looked old enough to be my grandparents.
When I close my eyes and picture her, my mind always zooms to me as a little girl, playing skellies and jacks and jumping rope with the other neighborhood kids. My forehead sweaty, pigtails flying, breathing heavily, hard at play.
When she steps out the front door of the apartment building and calls us inside for dinner. Always, she's in a house coat, like the very embodiment of Tyler Perry's iconic Madea character from the movies. Gray-haired, larger than life, older, brash, stern, a bit embarrassing. It would nearly kill me to turn toward her voice and see her standing there, her hand on her hip, that same house coat clinging to her body, waving us into the house for dinner. All I could do was hang my head and scurry inside,
hoping everyone would honor the code that it's not acceptable to talk about anyone's mama. I wouldn't have tolerated that anyway. Minnie had to love me in the best way she knew how, by providing for me. She didn't have much outside the checks she got from the state to care for us kids, but she stretched every penny to make sure we kids had exactly what we needed. We weren't the Cosby family living in a brownstone, wearing expensive sweaters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.